No, it was definitely a workshop. It was meant to be hands-on, and we weren't to answer questions. So I think we are going to now do that. So if anyone has any questions, I'm here, Jose's here, Jim's here. We'll answer whatever we can in the next hour or so.
Oh, so we're going to hold off on yours?
We're going to hold off a little bit.
Yeah, we...
Can I start off with a question? George?
I hate to admit it, but I didn't get much sleep last night, and it didn't have anything to do with the conference or anything like that. And I was not awake and alert the entire morning, and I think I missed something that you said about the replication effort that you've done with the device that I sent you. I heard later on, at the end, you said 0.2 micronewtons, which is about the same thing that Nembo got with the device I sent him. Okay. Did you see the transients as well?
Yes.
You did see
yes.
The
transients? Yes, I call them pips. Remember I sent
yeah,
you?
I remember pip and
yeah, they, but they were not as severe as yours.
And that's
were
because
transient,
it's not,
but they were in the right direction.
Yeah, you were using the Ecoscope software?
No, I was using a standard oscilloscope. A real analog type scope. You know, one of those old things with a funny looking
I remember storage oscilloscope where you pull the handle down.
Yes, okay. Yes, not quite that far back.
Yeah.
Yes, it was an analog scope and the same thing on digital scope too. But I like analog scopes when there are not when there are fast transients. If I want to see a fast transient, I throw my digital scope out the window.
Yes.
Or figuratively. But I did see some pips, what I call them, the leading edge and the trailing edge, you might say, of my thrust trace.
Okay. All right. Then theoretically, the reaction masses you guys now have should bring your devices into good form with the lights running forward.
I was going to ask on that in that regards. You gave me, Heidi gave me a brass reaction mass, and I presume I take off the
everything
old one,
else
and everything else is the same.
Everything else is the
so
same.
So torque out the torque.
Forget the rubber thing.
Right. Yeah.
There was a slight problem I noticed with the reaction mass. I think our machinist put the indentation on the wrong surface.
Oopsie.
So I'll just drill through the four holes and then thread them yourself. And then
okay.
I think you can do that. So
I think
it's just on the wrong side.
Okay, or we can make a small indent on that side.
That would work.
I would suggest to review the test with the old breast measuring that we did setup to see if it was conserved.
Oh, yes.
Because Jim mentioned that if the device sits there, it can.
Soak moisture.
Right, with moisture, absorbing moisture, and that can change the characteristics. So before making the change of the brush, I would do like that so that we can compare the results.
Yes, certainly.
Yeah.
And just make sure I torque the holes up to
four
was it each pounds?
On the 256s, 2.5 inch pounds on the 4 pounds.
Yeah. Well, all those details that
yeah.
are not
okay.
relevant to right now.
I just wanted to make sure that I hadn't missed anything.
No, what you really didn't miss, however,
in fact, I did.
What you did miss was one of my many concerns about prosaic effects. One of them was something you brought up, which is you mentioned what you called it the Lorentz air effect, where there is a possibility that you can give enough momentum to enough air molecules that they actually collectively produce a force that is measurable.
Lorentz force in the air.
Yeah. And anyway, so that was one of the ones that I put up in.
Yeah, the way that's taken care of is just simply running it at different pressures.
Right. Yeah.
Because the effect doesn't change with pressure significantly.
Oh, I noticed that you had some EM drive data, and maybe since we're going to be talking about EM drives tomorrow, maybe you could show us the data that you've got on that too.
Well, it's not data, it's questions about
a question. Well, how your drive day is tomorrow, I guess, so,
yeah, so we'll talk about it tomorrow.
Okay.
I would suggest that this is really important to characterize what is it that you are going to measure before you run the test. I think it's extremely important knowing that these materials are history dependent. It is very well known for 100 years that they lose their pollen completely, the fatigue, to characterize what this one is measuring. Because every time that you conduct a test, you're going through cycles through which you're imposing history of deep damage and so on, you have to characterize that. So I would run in the field spectrum, and I would look for the natural frequencies, because in your test, you're measuring a resonance in the field frequency, that's the natural frequency. It should be that frequency is staying the same. If that frequency is getting lower this time, you know that you have damage. Because why is the frequency going down this time? It's not because your mass is increasing this time. It is because your stiffness is going down this time. Why is your stiffness going down this time? Because you have cracks, and you have the bonding, and that is what produces your natural frequency going down. If your natural frequency is going down, that means it's occurring at a lower frequency, and also the amplitude and also the shape, you can see that it's a damage thing. Then, when you run your Mach effect force and you see you're getting a much smaller force, it is not proper a statistical analysis to compare apples and oranges, tests where you got very high forces with tests with very small forces, where one would assume that they are all the same thing. They are not, because one is a young, vital stack, and the other one is an old, decrepit stack that is full of damage. So that the young one is the one going to do much better. So you were talking in your presentation about the statistical analysis, and characterizing what you are measuring is very, very important, not just oriented, but spectral analysis.
To add to that, something that was passed over somewhat briefly was the fact that there's an accelerometer in the stack. I think Heidi mentioned that. And that is also a good, although subtle, way of looking at how the stack may be deteriorating. The comparison between the input waveform and the waveform that is produced by that accelerometer at the beginning of your series of experiments versus, say, the middle or the end, because that accelerometer itself will change its characteristics.
I will be there.
Because it's the same, it's the same material, as far as I know.
Yes.
It's an identical, identical to all the other crystals, or discs, rings.
They're just 0.3 millimeters thick.
Yeah, they're thinner. So they actually may be more subject.
How do you get the signal out of
that?
All right, so there's wires attached to that, which changes the structural integrity of that, right? By whatever bonding.
There's electrodes, and then we have tabs on the electrodes, and then the wires come.
Yeah. So in a sense, you have these, like you had drawn the stack with springs. Now you have these different materials in that stack.
Right.
So it changes the whole compliance.
Exactly. Yes, you're right. Not only to go down it, but now you have your whole thing that you're not worrying about the optimal mass. And you have now a system where instead of having equal stiffness in each spring, you have this spring which is much less stiff than this other one. You have a completely different thing.
Yeah,
so it sounds like, I mean, based on what you were saying, and what I think you guys have, you and Jim have determined, is that these things have a very, very, very limited lifespan before the material breaks down that's key to producing the effect.
In test devices, that's true.
Okay.
But when these things presumably go into some sort of commercial production, and you know that the thing's working the way you think it is, you'll be able to cool them and keep them in running order much longer than is possible when it's just an isolated device in a vacuum chamber with no real heat sink attached to it.
But independent of the cooling, you have just the high cycle fatigue that you
have. We have data. Remember, we have 100 years of transducer for sonars.
Yeah.
Right? So we have, there's a lot of data on this. You can go to billions and billions of cycles. But look at what we have here. Here you have a stack where every piezoelectric crystal is being bonded with an epoxy adhesive by hand, where it is mixed, and I think it is cured at what temperature?
120
Fahrenheit. It's all kinds of things.
So my basic question was, is, you know, assuming these are, you know, this produces real effects and you can scale these up, is the material science of piezoelectrics sufficient to allow you to have a long life thruster?
Yes.
Well, you have to be as skeptical, like Dennis was saying, right? Having saying, well, everything is going to take care of itself. We know that this is a well-known issue. Mm-hmm. We know it has been attacked in a number of circumstances. How has it been dealt with? Either with, for example, post-sinter electrode to piezoelectric ceramic so that you don't have the bonding, mm-hmm. or it could be an adhesive that has glass beads or other fillers, or another approach is to have a single crystal where you don't have any interface whatsoever. And the other part has to do with the preload. At the moment, I'm sorry to say this, but your preload is kind of empirical, isn't it? I mean, you have not run a finite element analysis to look at the properties of the material and the fatigue and say, okay, this is the kind of stress that I have to have. This analysis can be done all the time in aerospace. When in a general electric aircraft engine group, many years ago, we used to look at
triangles
for a while. So we're looking at the single crystal alloy turbine blade. We're looking at internal stresses, modeling this very well. None of that has been done here. So if you do that, then this can be taken to a level of billions, very, very high levels. Actually, people talk about so-called infinite life. It's quite a high level of technology.
Okay. Here's another weird question for you, Jim. Okay. Assume, you know, the this is based on my primordial understanding of what you guys do, right? So this stack changes its energy content, which essentially changes its mass, and then the universe reacts accordingly. In the same vein, if it's changing its energy and thus changing its mass, does the Earth react on it accordingly to give you a vertical component of displacement?
Yes, very slightly.
Very slightly.
Very slightly. Yes. Why is it slightly this way but not slightly this way?
Because the Earth's gravitational field at its surface is GL/R, the potential energy.
Oh, so you're just changing the location?
The potential energy due to the mass of the universe is equal to the square of the speed of light, which is a lot bigger than the GM overall.
Okay.
It's
only
most of the
inertia
effect is from the distant matter in the universe, and that's what
Maslin
said, that's what Lindenbell also said.
Yeah. Okay.
That is a question about an overview of Heidi's and Jose's presentations. Can you summarize now the, I think, at least three independent methods of arriving at Jim's equations? Jim's and yours and yours. I mean, is that a correct summary?
Oh, there's a fourth, George. There's a fourth. Lance has got his version.
Lance has got his version. Okay.
Yes.
With eight lines, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I have three different versions, I think, in the notes here. But that includes the Hohenlohe, it's just basically in the Hohenlohe equation of motion, field equations, essentially. In the limit of the smooth fluid approximation, but not going to the frame of the smooth fluid. So those are the three I have. I have Jim's method, and the method based on a geodesic, which is similar to Lance. I have a pressure race method, and sort of linearized
learning
method.
Can you write an executive summary, two pages, that summarizes the four methods very briefly?
I wrote this, it's more like
60-something
pages.
Can you write an executive overview so that the common man can understand it?
Yes, to Gary so he can understand it.
Yeah, Gary can understand, we can understand it. Yeah, I don't know.
There is a difference. Because I was looking at this very skeptically at the beginning, and I only was able to reconcile this, and this is where I am at the moment, looking at the kinetic energy, where I can see a clear way to get to it. I cannot see it.
Remember, we discussed about the same where you put mass, energy equals to mass times the velocity squared, and then this translates into things that don't have a mass. I can only see it when you deal with the kinetic energy. So that's where I see it, and then I see it then step by step. And even at that point, I'm saying, I think it's very interesting that the experiments are showing the same kind of behavior is showing in a directional force in the same direction as this calculation, and I can also calculate an optimal mass. Now, this could be a coincidence, but it's very interesting at this point. But I'm not there yet because there's this coupling factor, and I don't like to have any coupling factor, and I think that there's a lot of terms that are being dropped by going there, and then I did a lot of assumptions that are very clear stated, but I think they have to be better examined.
And another thing that my question corollary is there any crossover or in worst case circular reasoning, but the fact that with putting your theory aside, are Heidi's and Jim's and Lance's theories completely independent?
Are they the same?
Or are they?
They are three variants on making one assumption, two assumptions. One assumption is that rest mass is not a constant, that rest masses can change over time. The other is that inertia is a gravitational effect. And those are the only two assumptions you need. In effect, the three versions that you're talking about are three different ways of getting to the same answer. Okay? Simply by choice of approximations to make and things like that.
But they do come out different. I get something different, but in the essential aspects, they're the same, but there are differences around.
I'm just looking at it for the, as the editor of a physics journal or something like that, and I saw these three papers come in, and they're all essentially claiming the same bottom line, but I'm thinking, you know, logically, are they, first of all, are they self-consistent? Secondly, are they saying the same thing from different viewpoints, and so you should all put them all together, or publish them separate,
or state the individual assumptions that are similar or different than the other two.
Let me give you an example. Lance versus mine. Okay, what Lance does is he derives it from the geodesic equation and so on. Okay, and in order to get the result, what he does is he makes an assumption about the vanishing of the time dependence of the field quantities in favor of time dependence of source quantities.
I don't think so.
That's what I read in the thing that you did.
I just did a standard linear general relativity, like you do gravitational waves or the Newtonian limit.
I'll tell you what. Yeah. You can read Lance's thing, George. I assume it was available for you.
Yeah, I got a few free
ones. Okay. Okay. And you'll find that he has in there a comment about how his version differs slightly from mine because I insisted on keeping time-dependent quantities for the field quantities so that I would get the Dalembertian of the potential is equal to the sources. He gets the Laplacian of the potential is equal to the sources. Okay? But the time-dependent sources are basically the same things. Okay? So, again, it's a matter of his choice of approximation versus my choice of approximation. It's not a matter, I would say, of really fundamental elementary physics. He's not talking about something different, fundamentally different than what I'm talking about.
Okay.
Would you say that's a fair paragraph?
That's fair, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
If I can reinforce what I think I heard as a request, It sounds like some sort of a high-level comparison of the differences and assumptions might be very useful.
No, it's a difference between the theoretician and the experimentalist.
Well, that's okay, but I still think it might be useful.
I agree. We need to know what are the assumptions. You just said that there is a difference in the assumption being made. I would like to know what are the assumptions.
And also, if I could say that quick, there's a quick study that summarizes Jim's derivation. And so you guys all have a copy of that. It has all of the assumptions that Jim makes. It's straight out of his Stargates book. And then the one that I wrote up departs from that. But it doesn't have any of the assumptions Jim has. It's just, like I said, just the mechanical linear general relativity.
On assumptions, of course, there are two types. One was the inertia. But inertia seems like it'd be something that could be experimentally investigated. For instance, if you're looking at, if you have an expanding universe, then the inertia assumptions, or the inertia effect, should be different as you go back in time. So consequently, if you look at some distant object, there's going to be something you can look for to determine whether the inertia is valid. As it turns out, Wes, that's not true in general relativistic cosmology, because you're choosing one cosmological model. It's one that's spatially flat. It's the borderline between open and closed universes. And that has the odd property that the value of omega, which is a measure of this thing, which is equal to one in this case, is the same at all epochs. So all of this is automatically compensated for as the expansion takes place. So inertia in early epochs and inertia in much later epochs than ours will be the same as it is today, if that's true. Now you could do some experiments to see if it's not true.
Yeah, I guess it sounds like it's a slippery proposition, but if you can find anything.
Yeah, I thought it was slippery when I ran across it too.
Yeah. Look for search rate.
Are there any other experiments other than thrust or force experiments, called thrust experiments, that would validate, let's say, Jim's theory, that don't require measuring small thrusts?
That big thrusts.
Yeah, like big
thrusts. No, seriously, George. Yeah, I know what you're looking for, but I would say in the present context that what we really want to do is find a way of scaling the thrust with the meager resources that we do have available to us as quickly as we can. Right. And indeed, I've already talked with Jose about this. I'm going to be ordering a bunch of Steiner-Martin's crystals sometime in the next week or two. And perhaps you can join the conversation about what would be the ideal configuration for those. You know, because they increase the minimum order from 100 pieces to 200 pieces. Okay. So I don't want to get it wrong.
Well, in fact, this bothered me about your excellent presentation this morning was I was looking at all these very small effects that you were trying to mitigate by proper experimental design. But if you put a rocket engine on the stand, we don't pay any attention to the rotation of the Earth or the angle of the sun on it or whether or not it's in a vacuum. These are obviated completely by the scale of thrust. So this is why I always encourage more thrust, more power, if you will.
Since 2007, 1 millimeter, please.
As someone who's been selling rocket launches for a few years, we had this conversation. Yes, a demonstration of an unambiguously larger thrust that obviated the concern about many of these experimental error sources that you described would go a long, long way.
Absolutely.
Toward making this look real to a lot of people.
Right. And I just have to throw in an irony here, because I know a lot of people in this room come at it from the point of view, well, rockets are messy way of getting into space. And as a, you know, hot plumber, I agree with this, but I've blown up a few myself. But I think, ironically, the problem of energy dissipation, thermal dissipation in these devices, perhaps the problem of fabrication of super thin piezoelectric layers and sort of with MEMS technology and so on, might actually be solved by the technologies we use in liquid rocket systems for cooling, like platelet construction and chemical vapor deposition of crystalline materials. So I'd actually like to get, you know, the few of us who are, have some rocket engine experience, sitting down with the physicists to engineer a new device that could incorporate some of these technologies. Because now, having manufacturing a few other technologies that are readily available and cheap, we can do things today that we couldn't do even 10 years ago.
Well, so, other, you know, things like diffusion bonding, things like small channel laminar flow cooling is a great way to get a lot of heat out of the system. These are technologies that are being used now in other areas.
They might change the resonant frequency.
Yeah, the challenge is how those technologies change the physics of what you need to do.
But they might give you a system that, one, doesn't break easily, and two, you can get the heat out.
Well, I think there are more ways to deal with the heat in these than just cooling it like you do a rocket engine. Because a rocket engine runs at several thousand Kelvin. It's really, really hot. Mm-hmm. A PZT stack, if it got anywhere near there, would no longer function. It would cool down. So there are other ways to deal with it. My day job involves working with radars and the people who work on it. They can't get anywhere near that hot, and they have active cooling around many of them. Many of them are air cooled. But in this case, there's a thing that they use called duty cycle, which is the amount of time you transmit versus the time you don't. And some of that is based on heat, which is not shocking, because you can't heat them up beyond a certain point. So we could look at a duty cycle system. We have to figure out, we have to calculate out how much heat we need to take out before we try to do any cooling. Because we don't want to spend $100 to fix a problem that we can solve with a much cheaper solution.
I'm just saying there are multiple solutions that we can look at. It's not just a matter of focusing in on picking the right glue.
I agree, but we need to make sure we know what it is we're trying to do and the quantity before we go down that path, because it may be, you know, we're trying to cool a nuclear reactor, and so it's going to take an awful lot more than we expected, or it turns out that if we play some tricks, we can actually get something that keeps it below a threshold that gets us to where we need to go. Finding that threshold, though, requires knowledge on PZTs and characterizations that I'm not sure we know.
So I'd like to. I'd like to follow Gary's idea of, you know, where we could go with this. At the end of the day, you mentioned that there were designs, trades you could do to increase these power levels. I mean, these thrust levels substantially. And so, if I look at tens of micronewtons of thrust requiring 100. You know, watts of power, when specific power is, you know, 10 watts per kilogram, you know, I don't get a very big acceleration, and I haven't put a power supply in yet. I mean, I haven't put a payload in yet. Right. So what are the thoughts on how we scale this to something that is, you know, practical?
It's an aerospace question combined with design engineering. Packaging. If you take the approach that we've been talking about, three of us, has been to approach it from a PC board and then drop it down to silicon wafer as a model, but they're talking about some other sophisticated methods, but it boils down to about a 10-inch wafer where you produce 100 of these on the wafer. You do not dice, you use the wafer as the form. You begin your stack, so you can, Jim's case, let's say we have an 8 stack. Well, the silicon wafer is rather thin, but it's rather strong. So it's mostly dependent on the thickness of the PZT there. So you can build up big stacks. You can take 100 on a wafer. It requires 10 wafers to accommodate everything, the construction. And then you start stacking. And you can go 100, let's say you go 800 wafers high. So now you have a factor of 10,000. That's what the scaling is by multiplication. What is needed is for the E&M scaling and refinement in that area with the piezoelectric, pumping that out of the individual unit.
Well, it looks analogous to the solar panel with the radio, I guess, in the space application, when you start talking about cells and arrays like that. So you possibly could have a radio resistor.
Most of the technologies available today to do physical scaling, the onus on the physicist is to get to amplify and magnify whatever forces are going on in the PZT area. And it may be a confinement from the side, as Jose noted. It is when you squeeze that PZT or expand it, it's not just one dimension, it's actually expanding circularly as well. And so you've got a couple mechanical things you can do, you got some E&M to do, you got some packaging issues, and so it really is an integrated systems approach of what the various specialists are doing. But if you think about 5 micronewtons right now, and you multiply 10,000, you're up at 50 millinewtons, okay? Forgetting size, weight, and power for now. But it gives you a platform, at least so you can prototype in anticipation of future amplifications and magnifications of the fundamental forces.
But even before you do that scale, you were talking about ways that even this approach could result in more thrust than just micronewtons. Well, could you expand on that a little bit?
Yes, to me there, if I got this issue, the first order of business is, correct me if I'm wrong, I understand that you're doing this with guitar amplifiers and that you are setting these things by human operators.
Yes.
You don't have automatic frequency control.
No. No.
So to me, the first order of business is to have an automatic frequency control algorithm that that's the way with frequency operators. They can get you right into the frequency you want at a very small bandwidth. Again, I'm saying that you have to be at the bandwidth that is smaller than 1/2 Q, where Q is about 1,000. It's got to be a very, very small bandwidth. The people that are working on the EM drive, that are working at a much higher Q, are doing this.
Yeah, but at a higher frequency too, so
yeah.
It relaxes our frequency constraints.
Exactly. So there is this issue, automatic frequency control. And the next thing, but that's only, all these things are only going to get you maybe like 10 times more force, maybe 50 times more force, but like many people said, that's not what we want. We want to have 1,000 times more force. We want to have more than a million newtons. How is it possible to get there? And that's where I see all these terms that have been dropped out, and the one I question most severely, which I cannot defend, because I can defend a lot of terms that I show you. Okay, I'm going at a speed much lower than the speed of light, blah, blah, no problem. My kinetic energy is much smaller than E equals mc squared, no problem. But I have a big problem in saying that you're a believer or you're taking the position, okay, if the Mach effect is real, there is a variable res mass. If there is a variable res mass that is responsible for this, there is a term that is there next to the damping term. And most people neglect the damping term altogether, so saying damping is very small. But I mathematically, how am I dropping now this variable mass term? I have computed it and I say, well, according to what's going on here, it's not negligible. And what does it do?
it actually gives a Mach effect force which is much smaller than what it could be. Not by 10 times, by 1,000 times, by a million times. How could it be a million times? By parametric excitation. So one thing is parametric excitation.
The other one
is self-excitation.
Right. The other two that we've been looking at is our Andrew radiation and Casimir force. But, and that's not implemented yet in Woodward's format, but is in Pulse.
But before I get there, I don't want to talk about this. I'm going to be very skeptical when I look at the journey of that. I just want to get to something that is very down to air, which is nonlinear dynamics, which is used all the time for rocket technology. You know, you have pogo vibrations in the Saturn V that almost brought down one of them. All of them died. There are all kinds of rockets that have pogo vibration. Is a self-excited nonlinear excitation. It happens in all rockets. We're talking about rocket technology. So here, all this knowledge had not been applied. Because this is in all the knowledge that comes from nonlinear dynamics. So if it really there is a variable mass and there is a term there, there's a parametric excitation, and this could be used for the good. That means that it was excited so that you could get a very large force. Mm-hmm. I don't have to get into Casimir force or anything physical. All I have to assume is that there is a Mach effect force, and that's it.
So do you have a thought in your mind?
Is yes, I have
a... How to take advantage of this force to improve the...
Yes. The big thing that I have a problem with is that the computer the burden to do this is enormous, because I show you first 20 terms that are very large, and there are 256 terms. If you do math, when you add more terms, they grow. I don't know, is anybody using Mathematica here? If you try to use Mathematica in the biggest computer, and after a few factoring terms, there are so many terms that you get, they grow exponentially. So
we can rent computer time to deal with whatever you can throw at us.
Well,
okay.
That is a big problem.
You can buy supercomputers off the shelf.
Well, you can buy Amazon computing service.
Yes, I think that's probably a problem. It's something like that.
It's a big problem, but it's one you can throw money at, and you can get 100,000 cores overnight. Okay.
But how far will that go to suggesting experimental approaches to parametric amplification?
Well, in your case, the first thing I is when you're running the Mach effect experiment, what are you doing as far as frequency? How can you assure me that you are right at the resonance, and that as the resonance is changing, you are chasing me? What are you doing?
Well, same manual method as Jim was doing. So
that's not good.
So absolutely.
That's step number one.
Agreed. Step number one is obvious.
Yes.
But parametric amplification can come in a number of forms.
Yes.
And sometimes it's materials, and materials change that you exploit in a certain way to allow that parametric amplification. Sometimes it's an electrical, like a pump signal along with the main signal. There are a couple of ways of performing parametric amplification. The question is, would throwing an infinite amount of computer power at the problem allow the experimentalist to extract from that a new way of
So there's you have an example. Now, in the Van der Pol equation, you can form your circuit and you something that you really understand. The problem here is that we have neglected terms here, and I cannot answer your question because we don't know what we have. I don't know what is the mathematics of those terms that have been dropped there and what they look like. Only after I do that, then I say, okay, it looks like that. So
right. In the Van der Pol example, that was a set of equations that then were relatively easily converted into a little circuit.
Exactly.
On board, and you could see the voltage amplification going up crazy.
And that would be the case, that would be the case if the mass works out right, and there is self-excitation, which is an if that has to be shown. Because if you want to be pessimistic, it could be that this is impossible. You could say, all that these terms are doing is actually making your Mach effect force. This is one possibility. But let's say that it is possible that you can get self-excitation, then you could proceed like that, just like in the Van der Waal. Not by the material, but forming a circuit.
Yeah, in that case, it's taking known off-the-shelf components,
exactly,
putting them together in a particular way,
right,
and having an unusual result.
Exactly.
And the unusual result, but it is perfectly calculable through Van der Waal, but it was unknown until...
Right. That's because you know the equation, but in this case you don't know this equation.
Whereas in other systems, if you dope, let's say you dope your piezoelectric or piezoactive material like BZT with something, I don't know, what some kind of element or something, you might enable parametric amplification.
This is an excellent point. I completely agree with you. As I know about this much less than you guys. As I understand, Jim has tried all kinds of devices before the piezoelectric one. He tried also capacitors, right?
Yes.
And all kinds of forms of doing this. And we are going, I don't know if we're going to have the chance, but there is a fellow we are working with in France that has a model for the EM drive based on the Wilbur hypothesis.
Jean-Philippe, we're going to try and Skype him, and in that one afternoon session, we're holding breakouts, but people can have the afternoon off if they want, but if they're interested in the Skype session, this guy
I am skeptical of that model because I don't see it mathematically yet. Maybe he would convince me tomorrow. But so there is, that approach has been followed by Jim already. He looked at capacitors and so on. Maybe the MRI is one, maybe it's not, I don't know. That is one possibility. That's not the one that I would choose to go. I would choose to go the one on the aerodynamic because I'm good at that and I see my path there. So that's for other people.
I guess what I'm suggesting is, along with the assumption that somebody should try automatic frequency control, and that has to be discussed a little bit in more detail, but perhaps you could focus in on whatever nonlinear terms might be able to produce an approach to an engineering solution to the parametric amplification.
Right. And at the moment, I have no idea what they are.
Yeah.
I can see my way there, just like when I first got thanks to Gary, and then I said, hey, but I can analyze this and so on. I saw this. The first thing to do is to solve this problem. I can do that in a couple of weeks. That's what I did here. But now I can see this because we have solved problems, not only at MIT, but also in my professional life. I work for a German company. They have huge machines. Do you believe that they have all kinds of self-excitation problems? It was a big headache. Well, every time you get a vibration, you get all these experts that come with this equipment and they measure it. And all they think about, oh, it's something that is repeating itself. It's something that is out of balance. But actually, there's all kinds of industrial problems where you have self-excitation due to many times you have polymers that have the damping and it produces the self-excitation problem. I ran into it, and actually it's very interesting. We were all the time trying to solve it. This is the first time I ran into a problem where I want to do the opposite. I want to produce self-excitation until...
But Jose, it's to a point. You've got to be able to throttle the parametric amplification, or you will blow it up.
But that's where Jimmy already is, because somebody already said...
Pulse modulator.
Right. Jimmy's already running charge, which deals with one of the suggestions here, which was the duty cycle. Because chirp is a duty cycle.
Chirp. Yeah.
And also the chirp also deals with this. If I can, of course, I don't want to self-excite to the point that I want to blow my stack. I probably will do that.
Exactly.
So, but if I, no, once you understand the problem, and I have dealt with a number of self-excitation problems, they grow exponentially, but they have a curve, and you can chop it there, just like you're running the chirp. So if you understand the problem, which right, you can run something like a chirp and then cut it off. In this case, you, for example, all you have to do is just cut off the voltage. If you want to cut off the self excitation, that's where the whole problem is coming from.
And that'll become part of your auto-tune system as well.
You're right. And the other thing would be until changing the frequency, now stop changing the frequency and then you're going to fall out.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that many industrial problems are running into, they run into a self excitation problem, and then the guys get scared, so either they stay there or they reduce the speed, which is the worst thing that you could do. If you look at the backbone curve, instead of having a resonant on the top vertically, it goes to the side, and actually usually it goes to the lower speed. And actually they lower the speed and it gets even worse. Actually what you want to do is to go faster and to go get over it.
Have you ever heard an SSME winding up on the pad?
Synchronous world.
You got it. And you want to blow through that RPM
exactly.
As fast as you can.
Exactly.
Right.
So you want to overdrive it.
You got it.
Yeah. Right.
I would just like to throw in a comment. So you spoke a lot about electrostriction, right?
Yes.
So there's also magnetostriction.
Yes,
so
Michelle is working with. Yes, go ahead.
Okay. So completely other kind of material. Maybe there are no cracks in that material, like in PCTs or whatever. That could be interesting after Michelle.
I think that's very interesting.
Okay, but...
I was going to ask the same thing about that. Has anyone looked at the magnetostriction?
I didn't pursue it because I've been involved into this, and empirically, sonar, piezoelectric transducers 100 years, magnetostriction transducers are also around, right? So we don't have to reinvent the wheel. There's a lot of the technology out there, too.
Has anybody looked at it, though?
I know it.
I don't know. Yes. I did something, yeah. But not so, I mean, not analytically, it was not so refined like your. I mean, it was just an experiment that I have a paper we can discuss later.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think Jose's work helps define the envelope that BZT can operate in. And that's what we need to explore. What is that envelope? And then we can also then say, okay. If we say, instead of a BZT with this value, let's say we come up with a material with that value, maybe that's the best magneto or some other material that just comes off the block, then we can plug it in, see how it behaves, and start parameterizing it. And I think that's the strongest point of the solution. It's not, hey, let's optimize it. We can do that. We can also then explore, okay, within these parameters, what happens if I get a 10% increase here or a 5% increase? Or double this, or triple that.
Well, working as a team, we have to divide this. For example, this is an excellent idea about the magnetostriction. Somebody else, obviously, somebody else get that.
I'm working on that a little bit. I'm taking my first steps into that right now.
You're working towards the EM drive, not towards towards the.
I'm actually blending the two technologies together.
Okay.
Well, Joe's been busy.
Yes, I am.
What I saw as a problem during the experimentation is that if you use magnetostriction, you use large magnetic fields, okay? And you know, to shield them at the frequency that we are using, it could be a very big deal.
It is a hard thing
because it's relatively low frequency. It's going through every.
There's different ways to handle force within inside of a drive. You can ramp up your force using the TE mode, and then take that force with an external field and change it into like a TM010, which you can expel that force or use that force to influence your PZT materials and stuff. So you can start seeing two different effects, and also start seeing the parametric amplification. And this is where I started at about March of this last year, started taking steps to go into that. And I've seen some results, and right now I'm working on quantifying those results.
Yeah, I got a question about the experiments. For the piezoelectric stack, restricted from actually growing, like Pezlex normally do when you put power on it?
They're all pre-stress impulses.
They're compressed. They're compressed. Have you seen if the system grows any when you, at all?
It shrinks.
It shrinks?
Yeah.
Okay, so
when this is actually grows smaller.
So there is call it slop in there, but it's...
I would call it shake down.
But the reason I'm asking that with the magneto-restricted materials, your forces for stretching is going to be much, much higher than the piezoelectrons are. So you're going to have to confine them with less stronger bolts, we might say.
But those materials, I think that you told me, they are not as fragile.
Yeah, I was trying to use tonight, but you can produce with the technologies. Technology would be the best because it has
to be protected. You have to take that into consideration when you use the experiment.
I use the dielectric material to cure it.
Well, but frequencies, can you run really much higher frequencies of them?
Well, this guy, we didn't talk about that.
You have to think about it.
One conversation at a time, sorry.
And it's actually three dimensions.
So I want to just remind me of something here, which is frequency, but we didn't discuss that. If you naively go through the equation and say, okay, omega to the 6, omega to the 10, wow, that's a huge improvement with frequency, right? It actually, a running calculation doesn't turn out that way because you have damping with the crystal complex. So it looks like it's a very high functional frequency, but it really goes like the square or something like the 2.5 power. That's according to the model I have there. Now, I'm glad there may be another coincidence that actually the planets that
it's show between 2 and 3.
So that also makes me feel comfortable at the model that is also, I didn't forget to put that there. But he's modeling that, which is, it is not obvious at all, because even if you look at the equation, it says there is not 2.5 power. You just count because you have a frequency in the numerator and the denominator, it's at very high powers, and it's multiplied this and so on, and it comes up that way. But it goes up the frequency. So it means that the higher the frequency, it should go up like a square. So going with higher natural frequency should be better. The naive way to do things is what I write the by first, is not making shorter
frequency scale personal power. But then you have much higher dissipation, right?
Yeah. So it's all these things there that is quite complex because they have to be investigated.
So I think the only way then to do it is to use much higher voltages, right?
Which is not effective from the point of view of power.
Yeah.
Can you
try and keep power up?
Yeah. Also, I've seen that the amplifiers there's a limit on the voltage. That's
right.
A limit.
Right.
It's
all
in
the
power. It's not.
There is hardly anything.
So that brings you down to the paradigm that other people were saying. Well, let's look at other things and do piezoelectric materials.
You're going to put the right material limitation with frequency. But the bulk of the frequency, isn't this to be connected to the mechanical frequency of this thing?
Yes.
So if you are going to, for example, 2 megahertz, it will be something.
Theoretically, making it smaller would be better. But then, as I was discussing with Martin, if you go to only one or two layers, you have to remember that this crystal is not only expanding in the sigma direction, it's expanding laterally. At that point now, the lateral expansion is a lower natural frequency and it's bigger. So there's there are diminishing returns. We already know that going to one layer is not like, well, for the question, it's not good. Jim knows that empirically. Now the question is reducing 8 layers now, is 4 layers better? That doesn't be tried. But there is some room there to try, but going with this material, there are restrictions there. But then there's a whole gamut of piezoelectric material, because there are polymers that are piezoelectric, and there are composites, and there's all kinds of things that can be done here if one would have enough people and the budget.
Question for Jim. Jim, did you ever use quartz crystals in these stacks?
No. No, I inherited a collection of PCTs with a lot of 90 millimeter discs from Edo Corporation. They had a fabrication facility just south of campus, and they moved to Utah for tax purposes. And so they called up and said, we've got some stuff here. Does anybody over there want it?
I'm wondering if, since the quartz crystals have a much higher mechanical quality factor than the PZT stacks, or even the hard PZTs, they have a lower action, piezoelectric electro action.
Right.
But it may be that the higher quality factor trumps it.
But we have the historical experience from transducers for sonar, right? They started with quartz, and they moved to the PZT. However, you can take into account that for the transducer, you want to have high displacement.
That's right, we're not looking for high displacement.
I completely agree with you, you got it. We're looking for 40, and I'm looking for high displacement.
Exactly, so that's right.
It's not necessarily true that what makes the great sonar transducer is going to be the best Mach effect transducer.
Agreed.
But have you looked at some of the latest sonar transducer materials?
The latest?
You mean the security stuff?
Yeah. I mean, I'm not sure the Navy is really using regular PZTs anymore. I mean,
they're probably using PZT, PMN composite material that became fashionable about 5 years ago. It used to be you could buy PMN by itself, and now you can.
You have to make it yourself, which we did.
Yes.
Any sense?
But you can get commercial PZT, PMN.
When that firms up a little bit, then I'll spend the time looking into PZT, PMN composites. Yes, but I hear you.
What's the experimentally, what is the downside of making a boat instead of your little rectangular circuit box, or aluminum box, a boat in which you can fill with which you can fill with dielectric fluid and sink the MET or whatever in? For cooling purposes.
George, once you're satisfied that it's really producing thrust, and probably you and I and Nimbo in this room, well, Heidi. Heidi's watched lots of traces, taken data wee hours of the morning and all over. Okay? There are maybe a half a dozen of us in the room who probably figure this really is a good bet, that this probably will work, okay? Once you get to that point, then talking about pretty much any type of cooling process that doesn't mechanically disrupt the functioning of the device is a perfectly reasonable thing to do, because you don't have to worry about Lorentz forces in the fluid that might be making something appear to be something that it isn't.
So the next logical step in that thought process is to wonder whether Jose's equations can account for or can handle a fluid bath for a material of a specific density. Immerse the entire moving body in a bath of dielectric fluid.
So the first thing I've got to mind putting myself in your hat of a skeptical experimenter could be, I know that if I take a microscope, very powerful one, and I take a look at this material, I'm going to see all kinds of little cracks, and actually they may be interconnected. And now I'm going to be putting this in a fluid, and I know that when I do this, when it is expanding, the crack is opening, and now the fluid is going inside, and then when I'm going into compression, I have that fluid there. So then I have that fluid there that maybe is going to expand that crack, and I'm going to have an awful effect of this, because the fluid is going to make all these cracks and the Kolsinger quantum fatigue right away.
But also, you have these pumping your fracture.
Yeah.
But I was changing the mass distribution.
You have to. Is to have the something that doesn't let the fluid go
right,
to
right, but now it is the case, right? Because there is a box.
Yes, there's a box around it.
Then they are that kind of sealed.
I work with the boxes for a long time. They are the diffuse their water and they are permeable.
Yeah, now it's built in this way. The device, it has a box around it. Right?
That's not good enough.
Are you saying it is permeable?
Yes.
Yes, but it's not permeable to everything.
Not the pump.
It's water. Yeah, but not you. Don't use water.
Right.
Don't use water. Don't use.
Right. It's something to work on because remember your experimental things is one. It's one thing to worry about.
Well, let's assume that that's an engineering problem.
Okay.
Can it be calculated? Can it be fit into your model to see whether that damps the whole thing so much that it wouldn't be worth that kind of solution to the heating problem?
No, I wouldn't expect it's going to dump the any bending vibration in and out, but if you have the fluid out and I have a piston really with the fluid outside, so I'm not dumping because it's around the circumferential area, it's not.
Well, it's at the end. I see
that
you're
right.
You take a cylinder.
You have the no slip boundary condition between the fluid, and therefore that's giving you.
Assuming there's no cavitation.
Okay, so now we have to think about the fluid that is not going to penetrate.
Assume
it's going to have low viscosity.
Yeah. So, but it's going to have a good coefficient of thermal coefficient.
You're right. You're a very good point. So viscosity is going to kill you. So if you're going to start putting oil there. That is going to give you dumping, which you don't want.
Exactly, but
Jim,
you could use helium instead of using a fluid.
Yes.
Instead of using a liquid, use a gas.
So.
Helium has fabulous thermal transfer properties.
Yeah. Yeah.
The other thing too, from my very very slight knowledge of the commercial PZT business, they've got very elaborate. Encapsulation techniques, because this is a problem for commercial PZTs too, that when the surface of the PZT crazes, as Jose says, you set it out in a humid environment especially, the water vapor gets into the thing and it kills them. Okay. It just doesn't work very well at all. I discovered this by accident a few years ago. You know. But that can, in some cases, can be reversed just by putting the device into a vacuum chamber and pumping on it for about a month. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So,
gets the water vapor out of the cracks.
It gets the water vapor out of the cracks. Yes, you have to re-encapsulate it and all that. And yeah, I'm in the process.
What I'm wondering is, in that simplest of cases, where you have basically a vibrating cylinder in a bath of fluid, whether it's helium. With a known viscosity or density, whatever the maximum operating temperature of Jim's device he wants, which is what, 40 or 50 K C or something like that?
Yeah, probably I would say 30 to 40 K, 30 to 40 C rather.
Yeah, but
that would be.
Is that, you're not talking about a super cool.
Fluid at a room full above room temperature.
It would take fluid analysis to determine how much damping you're going to get. It'd be high temperature dependent. And I don't know.
Okay.
I think you're going to have a problem where to get enough heat off, you're going to have a fluid of a certain density, which is then going to damp you beyond the point of having it there. You're going to get caught in the loop, I think. It's not worth. I mean, it's probably worth evaluating, but I can see where you have to make the concern real quick.
It would be better to have a solid state thruster than any other type of media, because we can deal with the solid state stuff on rockets for lift, shock and vibration. I wouldn't want to put a fluid thruster, depend on that if you're undergoing high G forces.
No, I'm talking about for experimental purposes.
I would put it in every possible phase you can get it in. Liquid, solid, plastic, creep,
Well, my basic question is whether Jose's equations are amenable to adding this kind of fluid factor.
Yeah, I guess I think I will have to model the no slip under the condition there, and essentially it's a viscosity function there. Yeah.
Jose?
So, is it not there? Because there's no fluid structure interaction or anything like that there. No, there's no fluid. Yeah. So that could be done, yes.
We're talking about building physical models. Can we put this into COMSOL or another multi-physics program and reduce the number of models that we need to build?
My expertise was in finite element analysis, and I didn't use finite, because this is essentially used finite element analysis or any technique like such for problems that are the boundary conditions are very complex, right? If you have a structure that has a very complicated shape, but this is it's a cylinder, it's a very easy shape. So I don't see right away the usefulness of a program like COMSOL. COMSOL is a finite element program. I don't think it's a very sophisticated one. It has a Galerkin, of people.
Yeah.
It uses a Galerkin approximation. Not the best. It's not the best kind of finite element out there. And what is it doing for me? It's there to solve something that is very complex geometry. If I want to deal with a problem, for example, where I'm really interested whether I want to have one crystal or two crystals, where at that point I have to deal with an isotropy. Yeah, I can try consoles for there, but I already know off the bat that's experimentally and theoretically that's not going to be very good.
Right, it's actually very good, depending on what you use.
Go ahead, Greg.
I was going to say, we use it right now for acoustically analyzing rocket engine combustion chambers, including all the injection.
But that's a complex geometry.
Yeah, and so it works with that from
the I don't have a complex geometry here.
Yeah, yeah. So what makes you think it wouldn't be good for a non-complex chamber?
Maybe if somebody comes up with a Mach Effect device that has a complex geometry, okay, then that is a reason to use COMSOL. But at the moment, you have a cylinder, we can start
with
the equation for that.
By the way, the only way that you can build your own equations, they have a math section, mm-hmm. and you have to use very specific equations that they define. So if you can't put the parameters in exactly as they want them using these specific equations, there's no way to put your own equations in.
But you can define your own equations as well. There's that capability as well on that.
I've only seen the specific equations that you can use with certain parameters, and then you can change the parameters around. It's in the math section. I have not seen that you can put in a direct equation.
And the other thing is, it's a black box, right? It's a proprietary program. So I don't like that very much, because what am I doing here? Putting my own equations on a black box. I mean, there are programs like, for example, when Adina was first out, or Nastran, where you have the whole code. Okay, then I can see what is not a black box. Then I can see working with that. Something, for example, if I have a Nastran and I have the whole code, then it's not a black box. Then I can see using Nastran to model to put this equation there. For example, that could be Nastran could be one.
The process I used on COMSOL was to determine the eigenfrequencies regardless of the eigenvalues, the natural resonances, and then select certain frequencies, the eigenfrequencies out of that you want to test against. And what I was looking for was not a single frequency as the current level is. I was looking for multiple frequencies to avoid some of the dissipative forces and some of the interference.
Which brings us to another thing, which Martin also brought up. He noticed right away, he said, Jose, I just noticed you show me the spectrum there. The second natural frequency has much higher amplitude than the first natural frequency. Why are you guys testing at the first natural frequency?
Impedance matching. Impedance matches the lower end, so we have to just change it to the upper end. Yeah, sorry, I haven't got that far yet.
To which my answer
is... busy checking your equations.
There was a damaged tack. That's one stack. Reason. But the second natural frequency, I think, is very interesting. So there's a lot of things to investigate here. But the second natural frequency, you can also get an exact solution. It is just instead of being a two-mass, it's a three-mass system, and you can still get an exact solution. It's going to be more term, more work. I mean, you only need to go to a CAN program when you have, I don't know, 10 more natural frequencies where you cannot get an exact solution. So at the moment, again, to me, do something about them, get into a natural frequency and then investigate what's going on, what the hell is going on with the dumping terms here, with the variable mass and the dumping terms. Can you make this force much a million times or a thousand times bigger, or is that impossible?
Well, it's now just gone 5. I don't know. Should we adjourn to dinner and maybe continue the discussion over dinner? All agreement?